Did you guys get that? I'm sorry. I'm passing it off to now to Chrissy, Debbie, and Nancy. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you so much, Ryan. Good morning, everyone. My name is Christy Christensen. I've worked on this Ginnie Mae contract for about 4 years. And prior to working on this contract, I worked in mortgage servicing for about 18 years in the Atlanta, Georgia area. Nancy, would you please introduce yourself?
Good morning. My name is Nancy Strickland. My prior experience includes working for an issuer for about 12 years in investor accounting, and I've been working on this contract since 1999. I've seen a lot of changes and improvements over the years. Debbie, please introduce yourself.
Hi, everybody. I'm the newest member of Ginnie Mae Issuer Support Team, just a few months here. Previously, I was in investor reporting for 15 years in the Kansas City area. I will now turn it over to Christy.
Thank you so much, ladies. Well, we will just go right ahead and dive in. Let's use some of the tools that Ryan just talked about. Would you please raise your hand if you are new to the Ginnie Mae program? Wonderful, seeing quite a few hands. That's awesome. Thank you, Ryan, please clear the hands. And if you would also turn on the annotation bar for me, Ryan. Thank you. Do you have experience with Ginnie Mae reporting? If you are brand new, if you would use one of the stickers and place a cross on the left side of the screen. If you have more than a year of experience, would you please place a check on the right side of the screen? Okay, good. Looks like we've got some new folks and some people with some experience. So that is great. Thank you so much. And Ryan, if you could clear the stickers for me. So do you use a subservicer? If you do, could you give me a thumbs up, please? And that one is over actually in the raise hand at the top of your screen. Okay, I'm seeing a few green thumbs. That's wonderful. Ryan, if you could clear the thumbs. And then do you use an in-house system or a service bureau? Using the stickers, could you put a cross on the left side of the screen if you use an in-house system and put a check on the right side of the screen if you use a service bureau? We're just trying to get kind of a total of if we have in-house systems or service bureaus. Okay, so it looks like we've got one that's using a service bureau and some that pretty much everyone's using an in-house system. Thank you very much. And Ryan, if you could turn off the annotation bar, please. Thank you. This basic course is intended to train new Ginnie Mae issuers on monthly investor reporting, including the Ginnie Mae Reporting and Feedback System, which is also called RFS, along with additional important topics. This course focuses on monthly investor reporting requirements from a reporting and business perspective. Future training sessions will provide more detailed reporting requirements. Today, we will be focusing on these four bolded modules on the slide. In this module, we will explain the purpose of investor reporting training, list issuers' primary responsibilities, describe the characteristics of subservicing partnerships, and discuss consequences of noncompliance. A few hot topics that will be discussed during the training are Ginnie Mae reporting requirements, multifamily pool transfers. You need to notify your Ginnie Mae account executive of any changes to loan terms 30 days prior to the change, RFS enhancements, cash management, and specific topics or questions that you would like us to address. Please place any questions that you have in the chat box throughout the training. Issuers' primary responsibilities are having employees with Ginnie Mae requirements knowledge, a QC mortgage plan, ability to service Ginnie Mae pools within the MBS guidelines and guarantee agreement, also meet all reporting deadlines, maintain proper P&I and escrow accounts, ensure if sufficient funds are available for ACH P&I drafts, and if you use a subservicer, ensure they are compliant with all guidelines and reporting requirements. So what should a subservicing partnership be? It should be proactive on the issuer's part, ongoing, customized to your organization's needs, include all issuer responsibilities, and have an oversight and have an issuer oversight of the subservicer's monthly performance. A very important note, as a Ginnie Mae issuer, you are accountable for your subservicer's actions and reporting. For those using a subservicer, give me a thumbs up if you communicate with your subservicer weekly and a thumbs down if you do not communicate with your subservicer weekly. Great. I'm seeing green thumbs and not any red thumbs. That is wonderful. Yes, you should be frequently communicating with your subservicer. Ryan, if you would clear the thumbs. Now we will continue with reference documentation. In this module, we will list the available resources and reference documentation available to issuers, discuss useful resources for job tasks, and explain Ginnie Mae terms. The Ginnie Mae hotline number is 1-833-GINNIE-MAE-HELP. Why, yes, Ginnie Mae Help is one more digit than 466-2435, therefore the last digit is dropped. Option 1 is for the GINNIE-NET hotline with an additional 5 options, and option 2 is for RFS, which is for investor reporting with an additional 6 options. Ryan, would you turn on the annotation bar, please? So if you guys would please place a sticker on the option that you would select for RFS. Wonderful. That is correct. It would be option 2 from the main Ginnie Mae Help phone number. I will now turn it over to Nancy.
Thanks, Christy. This is the homepage for the Ginnie Mae website, which is www.ginniemae.gov. May I have a show of hands if you have visited the website ever or even recently? Ooh, look at all those hands. Wonderful. And great. Looks like most of the people have visited or is using the website. That's wonderful. Ryan, can you clear the hands? The website has a ton of useful information. It provides bulletins on the latest news, links to program guidelines such as the MBS guide, and the different sections of the guide, APM, notes and news, and issuer tools such as the pool dates calendar. Just above the picture are navigation tabs where you select the topic you would like to view. It's issuers, investors, disclosure, newsroom, and about us. At the bottom of every page of the website, there is a box to enter your email address if you would like to subscribe to notices and bulletins for several subscriptions such as APM, notes and news, training announcements, outreach calls. I received the multifamily training subscription email on November 21st that notified us that this was upcoming training and for issuers to go ahead and sign up for it. If you do decide to subscribe, please review the site every couple of months to see if any additional changes to if any of the categories, new categories have been added or changes to any of the categories. When you place your cursor on any of the tabs up above, like issuer investor disclosure, a drop-down box will show a list of the subjects that you can select. I have selected the issuers tab on this slide. You can see other sets of tabs for program guidelines, issuer tools, training, third-party provider, and program guidelines. I'm sorry, systems and applications. Within each tab, there are additional topics you may access. Please take the time to review and become familiar with the information provided on Jenny Mae's website. When you place your cursor on any of the tabs, here are the links to the website along with specific links to the MBS guide. The issuer tab provides access to such areas such as program guidelines, issuer tools, and issuer training. This includes the Jenny Mae MBS guide, APMs, and investor reporting manual. Now, once you get this document and it's once it's been posted on Jenny Mae's website and you pull the document up, these links below should take you straight to the document that is shown above. So those links are live. The Jenny Mae guide provides specific information concerning each program type. Specific to multifamily is Chapter 31, Project Loan Pools, and Chapter 32, Construction Loan Pools. We're also showing a link to the MBS guide appendices. The guide appendices are the instructions for certain forms that Jenny Mae requires for pool administration. One of the main appendices we will refer to is Appendix 6-19, Report of Pool and Loan Data. During Day 2 and Day 3, we will refer to this appendix several different times. The document provides information about Jenny Mae's requirements for monthly pool and loan level reporting, along with specific file layouts for all pool and loan records. Also provides the description of each alert or error message. The last two links are for notes and news and APMs and a link to the FAQ section. This is a short list of some of the Jenny Mae terms used that are sometimes confusing to issuers. One term is FIC. FIC is short for fixed installment control, also known as your P&I payment. Many issuers use the term P&I payment. Any of these terms, are any of these terms confusing to you? If so, please enter the term in the chat box. Okay, I don't see any responses, so I'm gonna go ahead and turn this back over to Christy. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Nancy. The next section is RFS reporting timelines. In this module, we will cover RFS reporting deadlines for pulls and loans, describe the sequence of actions within the timeline, including deadline of reporting pull and loan data, and also discuss when critical exceptions must be cleared. For each pull and loan package, issuers must submit 100% of their monthly pull and loan data by close of business, which is 7 p.m. Eastern Time on the second business day. Here we have a snapshot of important dates, which will be explained in more detail on the next slide. A quick story. A few months ago, we had an issuer who failed to report 100% of their pull and loan data. Therefore, they were missing a pull and a loan. They were reported to Ginnie Mae as missing the 7 p.m. Eastern Time second business day deadline, which may result in a monetary penalty from Ginnie Mae. This is a snippet of the full monthly RFS timeline. RFS opens on the 25th of the month for reporting. On the morning of the first calendar day, RFS opens for file submissions. Even if the first calendar day is on a weekend or a holiday, we work to open RFS. After the issuer's files are processed, RFS feedback is posted in e-notification. The initial pre-collection notice is available on the third business day, which is based on the second business day RFS pull record security RPB. Prepayment penalties must be reported by 7 p.m. Eastern Time on the fourth business day. However, penalties may be reported as early as the first business day. The final pre-collection notice is available on the sixth business day, which is based on the fourth business day final RFS pull record security RPB. The final pre-K must be reviewed for any changes from the initial pre-K, including any changes in the prepayment penalty amount. The monthly reporting certification opens beginning on the 10th business day, with the deadline being 7 p.m. Eastern Time on the 14th business day. The guarantee fee is drafted from your designated bank account on the 10th calendar day. Please see Chapter 6 of the MBS Guide if the calendar days are not business days. The P&I remittance is drafted on the 15th calendar day. Please see Chapter 15 of the MBS Guide if the calendar days are not business days. On the 25th calendar day, RFS closes for the current month and opens for the next month's reporting cycle. This slide and the next two slides is a complete monthly investor reporting workflow. We have received feedback where issuers use this document every month to check off completed activities. This begins on the 25th calendar day when RFS opens and continues through the fourth business day. Would you please raise your hand if you would use this document to ensure you are meeting the deadlines? Oh, wow, look at all those hands. Is wonderful. Thank you so much. Ryan, if you would clear the hands for me, please. So this shows the fifth business day through the 15th calendar day of the month. And this shows the 25th calendar day when RFS closes, and a few monthly, quarterly, and annual items, which we will be reviewing throughout the training. Ryan, would you please post our first polling question? Okay, so what is the deadline for reporting 100% of the pool and loan data? So we have 7 p.m. Eastern Time on the fourth business day, 11:59 on the fourth, 7 p.m. on the second business day, and 11:59 on the second business day. Okay, and while we're giving everyone a chance to vote, I do see a question here. Where can we get the timeline document? That document should be in a PDF format out on the Ginnie Mae website under the training, and I believe it's under tools and resources. And Ryan, I see a note there from John. Would you be able to reach out to John?
No, John said, I think that he was referring to earlier in the chat. Nancy was having a slight bit of her audio sounded good, but it just sounded like it was a little bit laggy or maybe a latency issue. It would like pause and then speed up real quick. But just as a quick reminder to not only the presenters but everyone in the participants, make sure everyone, I didn't mention this earlier, make sure we're off any kind of VPN or anything that might tether our network or limit it in any kind of fashion. So, if possible, disconnect from VPN. And if you get booted from the space again, I'll let everyone rejoin. But no VPN and nothing that might hinder your network speed. Make sure you're close to, a router, all that good stuff. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, Ryan. Okay, and Ryan, if you could go ahead and end the poll and broadcast the results, thank you very much. So yes, so the correct answer is C, or 7 p.m. Eastern Time on the second business day. Okay. Thank you, Ryan. So, I would like to ask if any of our Ginnie Mae account executives have anything to add before we take our 10-minute break. I see Patrick is typing. Okay, nothing to add. Wonderful. Okay, so we will now take a 10-minute break. When we reconvene to continue training, Debbie will be presenting. Ryan, if you could start the 10-minute timer. Thank you. So we will return at 10:48. Thank you. So welcome back from break, everyone. And Debbie, whenever you're ready.
All right. Good morning, everyone. Thanks for joining us today. I hope everybody's awake, had a chance to get your coffee this morning. In this portion of the training, we're going to discuss e-notifications, especially the importance of reviewing and the data that flows into e-notes. Our objectives are for you to be able to identify critical job alerts, which posted information is critical, and how to resolve or address the e-notifications. E-notifications, an online function accessible from RFS. E-notification supports investor reporting in other areas by providing notices and/or reports and documents. A few of the notices and their purposes are shown below. If you have not viewed e-notifications, can you please raise your hand? Okay, I see a few hands. I'm glad you guys are with us today. We can go through that for you. And Ryan, if you can clear the hands. The PA acknowledgement will generate to indicate if your file was accepted or rejected. You'll only receive the PA exception feedback if your file was accepted. The pre-collection notice will appear on the third and sixth business day. We have the daily and monthly unique loan IDs. We have suspense notices, letter of credit, notices from Jenny May. We have outreach calls, enhancements in MWX issuer detail report. This is a recent RFS enhancement. The MWX report generates once a year at issuer's fiscal year end and will remain available in e-notes for 180 days. We've been told that the issuers that have missed important dates now have added reviewing e-notes daily into their job description. Notices may be posted daily, weekly, monthly, quarterly, and yearly. The notices can be formatted or as raw data. Many of the notices are linked to the most available content. A good example of that is the pre-collection report. The report posts on the third and sixth business day. If you do not pull and save the third business day before the sixth business day is posted, you will not be able to retrieve the third business day notice. The data in the report will now show the sixth business day information. Showing on the screen is the PA functional acknowledgement report, which is posted when the file is accepted or rejected. Next notice is the PA exception feedback. This will post each time a file is accepted. If a notice was not saved, you can request the notice by contacting the Jenny May hotline at 833-466-2435, option 2. You'll need to provide the subject or title and the date posted. Raise your hand if you have access to e-notes. Yay, a lot of people. This is great. Oh, I see a couple of red thumbs down there. All right. Well, hopefully going through this will be a good preview, some help for you, and you'll get access quickly. Ryan, if you could please clear the hands. And you'll see that after you have signed in to Jenny May, you select Tools and then select eNotes. E-notification provides a method for your company to receive notices when an item has been posted. This is called passive email. Only one email address is used. A message will be sent to that address informing you there is a notice. The user must go to the mailbox to view. And since only one email address can be used, it's suggested you use a generic email for all notices. Here is a screen print of the e-notification screen. In the chat box, can you tell me why some of the notices are red and some black? Yep, you guys are getting it. You're exactly right. When the e-notification screen is reviewed, we can tell if you have read the e-note. And the commitment authority is posted daily. This is one of the e-notes that are overwritten daily, along with the pre-collection notice posted on 2-3, the third business day, and on 2-6, the sixth business day. We're going to select the PA functional acknowledgement and then the PA exception feedback notice to open. You'll select the subject you want to open and click on the name. After clicking on the file name, another box will open with a link to the file. Right click and open the link. File opens in CSV format. At this point, you can save the file as CSV or Excel. The functional acknowledgement report will provide the accept flag or reject flag. If you received the reject flag, what would you do? And if you could use the chat box for your answer. Yep, you guys are on top of it. Yep, you would find the reason the file rejected and correct the problem and resubmit the file. Very good. The same process with the functional acknowledgement report. After clicking on the file name, another box will open with a link to the file. Right click and open the link. File opens in CSV format. At this point, you can save the file as CSV or Excel. If the exception feedback is saved as Excel, you can format the file using any of the data. We have received issuer feedback stating that the data is sorted and passed out to different employees to clear the exceptions. We actually have one issuer that told us they give the employees different severity alert messages each month, so everyone is familiar with clearing the alerts. The document on the screen is the pre-collection notice. This post on the third and sixth business day. Does anyone know why this document is important? And you can use the chat box again. Yep, you guys got it. Yep, this document provides the ACH bank account info, ACH draft amount for the guarantee fee, and the P&I remittance. It also provides the date the ACH will occur. This document should also be used to reconcile your internal records to reported data in RFS, including the prepayment penalty draft amount in the purple oval. Thank you, guys. I will now turn it over to Christy.
Thank you so much, Debbie. So before we move on to our polling questions, I would like to ask any of the multifamily county executives if you guys have anything to add.
Hey, Christy. Thank you. This is Patrick.
Hey, Patrick.
Do you hear me?
I can. Are you there, Patrick?
Oh, sorry. I couldn't hear. I didn't know if you could hear me. Sorry about that. I just wanted to go ahead and say really quickly, the pre-collection information that Debbie went over is very critical to the multifamily division to make sure that we make sure that all of our issuers are putting in the proper information. And if you don't go ahead and do that, especially with our prepayments, you get on the naughty list for the multifamily division, and we go ahead and make sure we contact you. But it's also critical to make sure you're looking at this pre-collection notice every month, because it might be an error that you never thought you ever would see. And then next thing you know, the 15th, we're drafting whatever that number is. So you want to make sure you really look through that information. And that's it from me, Christy. I'll turn it back over to you.
Thank you, Patrick. And Jennifer, I did see your note that you didn't have anything to add. Wonderful. Thank you guys so much. So Ryan, if we could go ahead and post our next polling question. Wonderful. Okay, so what is the deadline to report 100% of the pool and loan data? So if you do remember, this happens to be the same question that we ask before our break. We do ask this again because this is a very important deadline. And we'll give it a few more seconds. Ryan, if you could end the poll and broadcast the results, please. Thank you. So it does look like we had 90% people select the correct answer, with that being a 7 p.m. Eastern time on the second business day, which is letter A on this one. Thank you so much. If you could post the next question. So what is the deadline to clear the critical alerts? Okay, we'll give a few more seconds on this one. Okay, Ryan, if you could end the poll. Thank you. So it looks like we had 76% to get this one correct. The deadline for clearing the critical alerts, which are the E and the C alerts, would be 7 p.m. Eastern time on the fourth business day. Okay, if you could post our next question. Okay, so can operations can confirm if you have read your e-notes? So this is something that Debbie went over. And if we could get all of our participants to vote, that would be great. And we'll give it a few more seconds. Ryan, if you could end the poll. Okay, wonderful. It looks like we had everyone get this one correct, 100%. That is great. And yes, we can tell if you have read your e-notes. And that is just like Debbie talked about, and you guys answered the questions about if they are the color red or black. So we can see that just like you guys can. Okay, if you could close the polling questions, please. Okay. Okay, so now as a group, we will analyze the e-notification screen. We will discuss the following list of items and actions for the notifications required. Okay, so the first thing we have here is our unique loan IDs. So that one is actually the third one down, and it says daily unique loan ID raw. So that one actually opens as a text file. So does any of our participants, would you like to unmute yourself and explain what you do with that file? Or you can type it in the chat box.
Hi Nancy, it's me, Brian Tom from Breakspin Funding. We check the notification daily for daily unique loan ID raw, and we add that to our database for each.
Okay, so you check it for the daily unique loan ID raw, and you do what with it? I'm sorry, it kind of faded out.
We add them to our database daily, just so we can keep track of all the new ones and then take your test.
Okay, wonderful. Right. Okay. And it does look like we've got a couple other people typing. So Pam says to verify the pull number and the loan amount with the internal loan number. Very good. That is exactly correct. Does anyone actually convert that file to Excel to make it a little bit more usable? Okay, John says, I don't believe I'm able to unmute. You have a program that converts the pre-collection notice to Excel. Wonderful. We get the daily unique loan ID and update your servicing system with the ID so it is included in the monthly reporting file. Excellent. Wonderful. You also have some Excel formulas in the worksheet that split the data and the unique loan ID. That's wonderful. So you're converting it to Excel. Nancy, do you have anything to add on this one? Or Debbie?
The only thing is sometimes issuers will contact us and say that they did not receive the unique loan IDs. And I think they get them from either their secondary marketing area instead of looking in e-notifications. So a lot of times we've walked them through e-notification to show them where this where the file is, where they can pull the number. So it is out there, it is posted, and at the end of the month, if you have like four or five pulls, you will get a file with all that data on it, not just the one daily unique loan ID.
Perfect. Thank you, Nancy. Okay, and then you can also get the unique loan ID from GinnyNet. And Nicole, we will discuss your pre-collection notice in the next one. So give me just a minute on that one. Okay, So we'll move on down to the pre-collection notice. So the pre-collection notice here is toward the bottom of the screen. It can be opened as a PDF in a formatted option or a text file in the raw option. So Nicole is asking, is it possible to convert the pre-collection notice to Excel without a separate special program? I'm new in learning. As far as I know, you would have to take the raw data and export that to Excel. You can open the PDF and convert it to Excel via Adobe tool. Okay, that's good to know. If you have that option in Adobe. You are very welcome. Okay, so our next one is our PA exception feedback. This is a list of your outstanding exceptions after your file uploads, like Debbie had went over a little bit ago. And so you could download this, which we will talk about on Wednesday's session, download it from exception feedback, or it is also posted as long as your file accepts in e-notification. Nancy, do you have anything to add on that one?
Only that it also follows where you can only open the most recent information. So if you've loaded two or three files, if you open PA exception feedback, it's only going to open the most current data that's out there. So if you loaded two or three files and you try to open the first one, that will be overridden by current data.
Excellent. Thank you. Okay, so our PA functional acknowledgement at the bottom tells you if your file was accepted or rejected. You know, so that's always a good thing to watch, you know, after you upload your file. Let's see here. So the next one is our issuer detail report. That is the annual MWX report with the fiscal year end information. This is the one that Debbie talked about that is a recent RFS enhancement. It will show at the bottom of your e-note screen for 180 days after your fiscal year end. So we think that is a really great enhancement, and we hope that you guys think that is. So then it looks like the custodial account verification and the matching and suspense, we will actually be covering that on Friday's session. So does anyone have any questions or anything else you'd like to discuss in our group discussion here? You are welcome to unmute yourself or type in the chat box. Okay. So then if you have any other questions, you know, at all throughout the training, you know, just please let us know. Also, we've provided our email addresses here, you know, where you could reach out to us directly, you know, or you are always welcome to reach directly out to your Jenny May account executive. Okay. Cool. So I will now turn it over to Yolanda if no one else has any other questions.
Okay.
Christy, I've got a quick question. Is there
sure.
any rhyme or reason as to how the unique blend IDs are generated? Just out of curiosity.
I said, could you repeat the question? You're fading in and out for me.
Oh, sorry. Is there any rhyme or reason, or is there any like guidelines as to how the unique IDs are generated? Just out of curiosity.
I am actually not sure about that. As far as I know, Bank of New York Mellon is the one that generates the unique loan IDs. Nancy, do you have anything to add on that?
I still could not hear the questions.
The question was, is there any rhyme or reason how the Ginnie Mae unique loan IDs are generated?
There actually is. They're generated once you issue or submit your data for new pool, new loans, the 11705, 11706, or whatever you do through multifamily PDM or whatever, it generates that number. Now, those numbers are generated in order. So if you, and multifamily probably doesn't see this as much as single family does. If you had a pool of 50 numbers, they are generated in order. They don't miss a number. And then the next person that generates a pool, it picks up from that number and goes on. So it's not just a random number. They're following a list of approved numbers, and then they're generating the report and assigning it to the loan and the pool. So it's not a, it's not just a random number. It's a set of numbers that are already predisposed to be used for unique loan IDs. Did that answer the question?
I believe so. Thank you so much.
Yep, thank you.
Thank you. Okay, do we have any other questions before we turn it over to Yolanda? Okay, thank you so very much.
Awesome. Is everyone able to hear me okay?
Yes, ma'am.
Awesome. Thank you all again for attending today. We hope that this training was beneficial to you as always, and we hope that you all learned something perhaps that you didn't know, or this session served as a refresher of some sort. Again, today's training session was recorded, and in the coming weeks, you'll be able to find both the recording, and perhaps later on this week, you'll also be able to find all of our presentations on Ginnie.gov. I entered the links for both the presentations once they are loaded, and the recordings as well, how you can find them once they are posted to GinnieMae.gov.